Want to talk about that Nebraska ball game against Iowa on Friday. Coming off of that Purdue win earlier in the week, I guess how disappointing was not necessarily the result, but Nebraska kind of got popped in the mouth early and they made it a little bit of a game kind of going towards halftime, but really were never able to kind of threaten the way you would maybe hope they would after that big win against Purdue. Just in your mind, kind of walk me through the, I guess, how you processed where you, how you think about Nebraska basketball now, considering, okay, two of their last three games, they kind of got popped by Wisconsin and Iowa, but in the middle, you have maybe the best winning program history.
Yeah, well, it was certainly a good win against Purdue. And so, you know, Iowa, what I would say is that, because Alec had a great interview on Friday night, you know, and he said a lot of things that I think were helpful. And the bottom line is Nebraska has to go into every single game really prepared to play well and hard from the jump. This is not a team that can get off to slow start. And I know they climbed the mountain and they actually took a brief, I think, 1-point lead against Iowa. But this is not a team that can afford to fall in a hole. And they fell in a hole at Wisconsin and Iowa. And some of that is just mental preparation. You know, some of what it is. I would say it's true the women's team, too. That they really can't afford to fall into a hole either. excuse me. Have a cough for whatever reason this moment. You know, Creighton's a little different. You know, I think Creighton can fall behind, you know, 23-9 and shoot their way back into it. And they've done that before. And probably will at some point this season. But understand that Creighton plays at a pace that is, if another team is willing to go with that pace, then Creighton can really get it going. And so you'll notice that when Creighton struggles, they're playing Villanova, they're playing St. John's, they're playing teams that slow it down and run a lot of ISOs and run a lot of two-man game because they're trying to take Creighton's pace away. Nebraska needs to think like the opposite, but it's not always easy for them to do. When Nebraska goes and plays Iowa, it needs to slow the pace down. But their natural tendency is, you know, hey, this is Fred Hoiberg, we're going to play free. Let's rock and roll. Let's get up here. Let's do some things. And that's just, they're playing into the hands of the opponents. We've seen it three times this year now. We saw it against Wisconsin. And Wisconsin's not a fast team, but they are a finesse team, and they hit a bunch of threes. We saw it against Iowa, and we saw it against Creighton. And in each game, especially in the Creighton game, Nebraska's out here screwing around, you know, taking shots seven seconds into the shot clock. I'm like, what are you doing? You're playing right into the hands of the team that wants to run. And so against Purdue, I thought Nebraska did a great job of coming out, moderating their tempo, getting the shots they wanted, and then, you know, taking it right to Edie. And then, of course, the other thing that I'll say is that Zach Edie can't make a shot beyond 15 feet. And Nebraska loves playing teams like that. Oh, you have a center who can't shoot? Great. Mm-hmm. We love that. And when, you know, I've got two who can shoot, and Cricky can shoot, and that's hard. That's hard for Nebraska. And so they're going to play a team on Wednesday at Rutgers. They match up really well with Rutgers. Rutgers wants to walk it up the floor. They're not very good this year. They lost two of their best players from last year. They have a center that likes to just sit in the lane. He's not playing very well. And so, you know, a lot of it's matchup. And Nebraska's got to get better when they play a team that wants to run, of slowing it down. They did it really well against Michigan State because Michigan State loves to run. But in some other games this year, they struggled. And I think you've got to go into every single game with a tenacity and a competitive mindset. And I think Hoiberg tries to give them that, but they got to do that themselves. And these are all grown men. They're like 23, 24 years old, and you know, they could kick my rear seven ways to Sunday. So this isn't a bunch of kids. These are men, and they can decide as men what they want to do game in and game out. And I think Josiah Alec was trying to hold them accountable on Friday night. I thought he did a nice job.
Sam, last thing on Nebraska basketball here before we kind of move on to some other stuff. How much of it, I mean, everything you brought up, I thought is fair points. How much of it against Iowa versus against Purdue is just Nebraska made 10 more threes against Purdue and went 14 to 23, and they went 4-26 against Iowa. Like, how much of it is just, hey, they didn't make enough shots?
Well, I think shot making is not always, but often a byproduct of A, the tempo that you're playing with, B, the rhythm and comfort with which you play. And so, like, you know, I understand that in recent years, and I see this with my own writers, there's a kind of make shot, miss shot mentality. And believe me, I understand it. However, if you watch that game, you know, Iowa's really in rhythm and they're taking a lot of threes that they want.
Mm-hmm.
Nebraska's threes, especially in the second half, were not in rhythm. They were against the 2-3 zone. They were 2 to 3 feet behind the 3-point line because the zone is extended to the 3-point line. And they're kind of taking them between two defenders, and they're not really at their spot. You know, C.J. Wilcher, that's not his spot. C.J. likes to take the three right at that top of the key. He wasn't really able to get that shot. You know, so in those circumstances, I feel like Hoiberg has the freedom to be able to say, hey, case they can do this. The rest of you guys, you don't have that green light against that zone to take that three without paint touches. Like, you have to find a way to get to the high post and then get it back out. And they never really got to that. And so I think some of it is the quality of the shot you take. And, you know, again, we're talking about Nebraska, but Durman is as smart about this stuff as anybody. And he'll often say in his postgamers, he'll say, we took the shots we wanted and we didn't make them. And when he's saying that, he's not just saying, well, you know, we took three pointers. We took open three pointers in rhythm and the flow of the offense. And then we didn't make them. If all those variables are true, then I do think it becomes a make shot, miss shot game. I think Nebraska's game against Iowa was not that. Conversely, against Purdue, they just made a lot of shots that honestly weren't in the flow of the offense either. I mean, they were unconscious. It was a great night. It was a lot of fun. I was glad I was there. You know, I don't really cover Nebraska basketball that much, but my goodness, I've been there for a lot of weirdly big games. I was there for North Dakota Sunday. I was there on Tuesday night. I've been there for a few other games that, you know, I really didn't have that much of a reason to be there for. So yeah, all those things are true. We'll see where Nebraska. I like Nebraska's chances to win at Rutgers.
Mm-hmm.
And then they have not matched up well against Northwestern. And we'll just see how it goes. We'll see how it goes, because Northwestern has been a traditionally difficult matchup for Nebraska in the last 5 years.
Sam, let's jump over to football. The coaching carousel is moving. One name popped around. The Arizona job is one this state knows a lot about. And it's kind of a trio of questions, but it'll build into one answer. Do you think the state of Nebraska is ready for the return of Scott Frost? How likely do you think it is that he is, you know, highly considered for the job? And three, do you think the college football world is ready for him to be a head coach again?
Nebraska fans will be fine. I wouldn't be surprised, I guess, if Arizona hired him. That wouldn't be the hire I would make. I think Scott could be an interesting head coach in sub schools. I think, you know, he's an elite coordinator. The head coaching role takes a level of, I don't know that he's proven that he even really wants to be a head coach. Like, when he was at Nebraska, I never got the sense that was a role he really enjoyed. I think the thing that he really enjoyed was calling the game on Saturday and calling the plays, which is a kind of authority, but is not ultimate authority. And so I think, you know, he is, I think, very comfortable in crafting game plans and making things happen and being the chess master. I think that the head coaching role has become, in some ways, just a list of things that most people would not put at the top of their list if they were a football coach. And you have to be very comfortable in that space. Is Arizona a school where you can maybe get away from some of that? It is, absolutely. And so maybe that would be an opportunity for him, but we'll see. We'll see what they decide to do. I mean, that would be an interesting choice. You know, there's other options out there. And you know, if he goes to that role, he's going to have to kind of deal with you know, going the questions and having to kickstart all those things again. And I don't know what Arizona's looking for. Every school has to kind of decide who do we want to be. And if Arizona's looking for a fun offense that, you know, wins 8-9 games every so often, and but has some seasons where it's WTF, and you can hire Scott Frost. I'm just being honest. And not every job's equal, and not everybody can do the same thing at the same place. Like, that's really important. There are teams in college football that should run the triple option, and they refuse to do it because they harbor the delusion that they're going to win a national championship that they're never going to win. And so they refuse to run an offense that would win them 7 to 8 games a year, and we get them in bowl games every year because they're under the delusion that they need to attract players and quarterbacks who want to go to the NFL. Georgia Tech had a perfectly good system with one guy, and they got rid of it. And then they got another guy in there, and he didn't do anything. And the other guy is going to not do much either because they had the system that fit them, and they just weren't satisfied with the idea of never being able to win a national championship. Well, that's fine. And so, you know, I don't know what Arizona wants. I don't think it's got the national championship kind of coach at that level. But he could, you know, he could score points and he can win you some games. I would compare him to like a Cliff Kingsbury, you know, kind of like that. I don't know that Kingsbury was a great head coach even in the NFL. But he was, you know, he was dynamic and they scored points. And I think Scott can give you all those things. And if that's what you're looking for, I think he can build a really, really good career out there. And you know, he belongs somewhere. Probably as a play caller, maybe as a head coach, but you just got to know what you get. You know, and I don't know that you're, you know, that would be what you were getting, a coach that kind of a Dana Holgorsen type. That's a good way to put it. Kind of that kind of guy.
Sam, we got a few minutes left here. Since the last time we talked to you, I'm pretty sure Nebraska has gotten Isaiah Nair, Jamal Banks,
Dante Dowdell,
and the linebacker Thompson, not to mention
Micah Mazuka.
Mazuka, the offensive lineman as well. How impressed have you been with the ability for Nebraska and Coach Rule to upgrade positions of need and do so in a pretty surgical manner in the transfer portal?
Yeah, I mean, they're going to work really hard, and that is a hardworking group of football coaches, and they do a hell of a job of mining, you know, data and working their relationships. And so Michael Mazuka was some guy from way back that they kind of knew that they had recruited a long time ago, didn't get him last year. They did get him this time. You know, obviously Thompson played for Tony White, and Jamal Banks is, you know, looking for another school, maybe a little bit more of an opportunity than he had at Wake. So all these things, you know, and they do a really good job of working the relationships. And then it becomes a question of, okay, you know, how do we manage this roster financially? Obviously there's going to be some NIL deals out there that are being executed that maybe in lieu of a scholarship or things like that. And so I think they've done a pretty good job of building it. And I think the thing that they've done the best of is retaining. I mean, they had incredible roster retention. Guys want to come back for another year of this. And I think that speaks well to the culture that they're building there. And we'll, you know, so the additions, I think a couple of them will probably be starters, and that's going to be positive. But I think they've done, Nebraska always wins the offseason, right? They do a good job of that. Matt Rule does a good job of that. Now we wait for what the coaching option is going to be at quarterback, if they're going to keep it the same way or they're going to change it. And then, you know, we got a long wait till spring football. It's going to be 2 months basically from today. So it's a long wait. There's going to be a lot of talk season before spring football because they're waiting until after the break.
Sam, the two things Nebraska football does best, the off season and talk season. That's what we do.
That was a very disappointed yep.
Yep. Hey, who knows? Maybe they'll play better during football season one of these days as well. Sam,
I think they will. I think it's coming.
I really do too. I really do. That's Sam McKewon from the Omaha World-Herald. Sam, we appreciate your time. As always, we'll talk to you next week.
Take care.
Thanks, Sam.
That's Sam McKewon from the Omaha World-Herald on the War Horse Sportsbook Hotline. you know, with the question you asked about Frost to Sam there, it brought up something in my mind.
The wheels were going?
The wheels were turning a little bit. Something I want to ask you. Also, Peter King with some interesting thoughts on what might be happening in Dallas coming up next year on Hurrdat Sports Radio.